Hi, good afternoon. It's a big crowd we have out here. Reminds me of, my husband and I are a couple of working parents. So when we had young children, right after lunch at daycare, they'd spread out those blue cots and the kids would lay down and fall asleep. So on the West Coast, we're after lunch. Hopefully folks on the webinar or the webcast, it's not right after lunch and you've got your afternoon extra burst of energy. But for those it's right after lunch, I'm going to tell a story. So we can think of it as after lunch story time. So my name's Ann Hungate, and I'm here today to talk about service virtualization. So next week will be my 24th anniversary in technology. That's I did start right out of junior high. But I've been working in technology a long time. I've worn a lot of hats. I started out as a developer and a tech lead, moved into a solution architect role, slid over to business analysis, and then spent quite some time doing program and project management, portfolio management. In the last 7 years, I've worked predominantly in quality engineering, so working on practices that help organizations move defect identification and resolution as early as possible into the software delivery lifecycle. So first thing I ask is if you guys, we're going to get through this, and hopefully I've left enough time for questions. If I hadn't, on the slide here's my email address. Please feel free to send me a question. Just put service virtualization in the subject line, and I'd be happy to answer any questions. The second thing is, and I'm especially reaching out to our online folks today, I challenged my 19-year-old nephew. He said there's no way I could get 1,000 Twitter followers in a year. I got 175 in 5 weeks, so please, this is my Twitter handle, at Ann Hungate. Please go ahead and follow me if you're going to live tweet today. Throw my handle out there. If you're going to live tweet, also use the hashtag for this session. For the conference. So far, I'm hearing great things about the conference, so I just want to thank Lee and his whole team. You guys have done an incredible job putting this together, both the live and the virtual. So with that, we're going to go ahead and we're going to start talking about service virtualization. So I need to do an audience poll, and I'd love to do an online poll. I'm not quite that sophisticated yet, so I'm going to do an audience poll with folks we have in the room, and I just a show of hands, how many people here are part of a quality assurance or testing team? All right, so about half the room. Folks in the room, how many are using service virtualization in their organization right now? Okay, we get nobody using service virtualization. This is good. Then this is... I'll try to tailor the conversation then right to the initial implementation. Folks on the webcast, if you're already users of service virtualization and you feel like you need a refresh, we're gonna zoom in on that. So this question is moot. If we have folks who are not using service virtualization at all, it doesn't really matter if you're getting full value. I can tell you the first time I put in service virtualization, we fell very far short of getting the real value out of it. So if you're not familiar, any folks in here, who is not familiar at all with service virtualization? All right, great, great. Then I'm going to offer this definition for you. You can read it, but I'm going to give you an AND definition. This you can grab out of Wikipedia. That's where I grabbed it. I like to think of service virtualization as a pitchback. Anybody have a pitchback? That's what that picture is. Anybody ever have one? Come on, you guys. All right, so I have a bunch of brothers and sisters, enough to field a basketball team. But inevitably, I'd want to play catch and somebody wouldn't want to play with me. Or my brother would want to play and nobody would want to play with him. So my dad goes out one day and he gets a pitch back. I'm like, what's this? He said, this is so I stop having to hear you complain about nobody to play catch with you. Just throw the ball at the pitch back. It'll come right back to you. It's really what service virtualization is. Service virtualization is a chance for us to emulate dependencies. This is very much a developer tool by developers, for developers. It's a game changer. It is, I don't, generally when I do my talks, they're on leadership. And you'll see it if you follow me on Twitter. It's on leadership, process, engineering. Service virtualization is the one and only tool I will talk about because I think it changes the way we think about software engineering. When I was a developer, I'd deal with the dependency, and if the dependency wasn't ready, I'd stub it out. I'd ignore it and move on. But when I ignore it and move on, I don't have a chance to test the way I handle the response to a request that I sent. What service virtualization does is it lets us just build a veneer, some sophisticated stubs, real responses. So I reach out to another application and I ask for data. I get just the data back. So service virtualization means there's nothing happening behind the screen, but on the front part, you're going to get a real response to your request. They're quick, they're easy to set up. You can use virtualized services for dependency calls, for data, for systems, anything. It could be a vendor that you're waiting for to send you something. It could be another application. It lets you handle or test, validate the way you handle a response. Make sense? Extremely powerful tool. Three things I want everybody to walk away today. You know, an hour and 7 minutes from now when we're done, there's three things I want you to be able to do. The first is know how to pick the project where you're going to get started. I'm just saying, do not try to roll out service virtualization to your entire organization in one effort. Start with one project, a proof of concept. And we're going to talk about the three factors that go into choosing that project. The second thing I want everybody to walk away today knowing is how to build a business case. We're actually going to go through some exercises where we look at the math, how we understand the value, the hard benefits that go with service virtualization. And the last, and I think the most important piece, is how do you set up your organization to use service virtualization ongoing. So we're going to go through those. Again, as I mentioned earlier, this is your story time because I think messages are best conveyed in the form of a story. The first technical book I ever read that I loved was The Goal by Eli Goldratt. Did anyone ever read that? Great, great manufacturing book. But he wraps up all these manufacturing concepts in a story where he's actually making changes in his own life and he's having aha moments about a manufacturing process. So I'm going to tell today a story, and every story starts with a setting. So my setting is a classic financial service institution. A complex environment, conservative, regulated, but a lot of pressure, competing priorities. My setting also includes I'm working in a front-end delivery system, so direct channel. Think e-commerce, telephone, mobile, front-end, where we're relying heavily on back-end legacy systems of record. You know those systems that we built back in the late 80s? Thinking that they'd only last 10 or 15 years and they're still around right now processing our most crucial transactions. And the people that are running those systems, that are dealing with requests to handle regulatory changes, back-end changes, to gradually move now to these sophisticated package systems. These people have a lot of pressure. And here I am over in this the customer-facing web front-end, they considered us window dressing, and we're making requests from them. Another dimension of our setting is that the organization is moving to a more collaborative environment, a classic waterfall environment, now starting to introduce some of the agile concepts. A lot of the presentations we've heard earlier today, you know, were Michael Baugh's case study might have happened here. So this is, it's an organization moving from the classic waterfall to more agile. That's the setting. Make sense? Different groups, competing priorities, get it done faster, fewer defects. I don't know how many people were sitting in on Cheesy's conversation, his session right before this, but we talked about production defects in that and how you would get those into a cycle and account for the velocity. I can tell you some of the challenges our team faced is legacy defects from weak software development practices put in place with this pressure to be deadline driven. So you guys get a sense of the environment? Let's talk about the characters, because every story has characters and our protagonists today, and these names have been changed to protect the innocent. But Ken, we're going to start with Ken. Ken's my favorite character in the story because Ken's the person who introduced the concept of service virtualization to me. Ken owns an application suite. He has got three major groups of applications. He supports a line of business. So Ken's a little pie in the sky. He's an innovator, a big thinker, an amazingly collaborative person. But he really works at the big picture. He's got three major app suites. He's not down in the weeds and the interactions of the people. He's looking at a macro level. How am I going to be able to get software out faster than meets the demands of my client? Ken has a couple people on his team who work for him that we're going to talk about today in our story. We're going to talk about Benny. Benny owns one of those Ken suites of apps. So Benny is the manager. He's got the team that does the development on that. He's charged with getting his team set up into agile lines. So there's fixed lines, and he's charged with learning how to break stuff down into individual stories. Benny is held accountable for the application's availability, incidents, outages, the whole thing. This is what he owns. June, same thing, but a different set of apps. Next character in the story is me. And I'm going to use my own name because you already know it, and I already want you to be my followers on Twitter. So no sense in protecting the innocent. I'm not innocent. My job, I ran a horizontal. So not only did I support Ken, but I also supported Barbie and Skipper. Did the same kind of thing as Ken, but different lines of business. So my team, SQA, had requirements. I know I met a couple BAs already out here today, so we got some BAs. So we had requirements analysis, we had testing, we had test automation, we had metrics, software metrics, understanding the health of our products and our processes. So I ran a horizontal across several app owners. On my team, we're going to talk today about my long-suffering test manager, Daniel. You guys, have anybody in here, show of hands, who knows what I mean when I say long-suffering test manager, right? You've been working in waterfall, and the message you get if you're managing a test team is, why didn't testing catch this? Or, you guys cost way too much. Or, your team really stinks. Why don't the testers get it? So Daniel's already been through the ringer, but he's very resourceful, and he's learned to deal with that pressure, and he's learned how to use an onshore-offshore model to really follow the sun and get the work done, even though his timelines are always getting compressed, and he's always missing data, and he's getting late codes and late changes. He's figured out how to make it work. And the last person character in our story, team, we're going to talk about is Edward. Edward runs the shared services group we called Application Engineering. Edward's job, I thought I had a horizontal. Well, Edward crossed the entire organization, so he had dozens of Ken, Barbies, and Skippers to deal with. I just had three. Edward's job was to standardize our application development practices. Anybody in here read How Google Tests Software? Because you can get autographed copies out there in the lobby. It's a great book. It's a quick read. But a lot of the principles in that book is what Edward's job was. So that book really states that you get predictably better software when you have clear rules and expectations for application developers. You have one set of libraries. You have one language, one application server, you know, just really strict rules. They don't stifle your creativity. They make it easy to find what you need and maximize reuse. So that's Edward's job, and his manager is Gus. Gus owns service virtualization. Now we're going to get into the plot. We got the setting, we got the characters, you guys know what's going on. So step number one is picking the right project. I'm sure you guys can all relate to this. You guys ever have those days where you're back to back to back to back meetings? You don't even get a chance to go to, you know, you're bringing your lunch with you, you're carrying your water bottle with you, you're trying to read all your emails on your phone because you're not going to make it to your desk, but you still have to leave on time because you got to go pick up a kid to get somewhere. That was my day. I'm back to back to back to back, and Ken shoehorns this meeting into my schedule. I'm like, you got to be kidding me. How am I going to get to one meeting? So I'm juggling things around. I go to this meeting. Ken's asked that both Edward and I show up. The only reason I did all that is because pie in the sky, but the guy is great. I wouldn't have traded Ken for any app partner in the world. If he wants me to be there, then darn it, I'm going to be there because Ken asked me to, and he's my default lunch partner, and you never let your default lunch partner down. So Ken shoehorns this meeting in. Edward didn't make it. Edward's like, no way, man, this is too late. I can't be there. And Ken has this vendor in here, a vendor I've never heard of before. And they're pretty new in the market, and they have a new product. And they brought an engineer. They had a sales guy who did some quick intro, but then this engineer really starts talking about how he's developed this tool called service virtualization. He was a developer, and he made this thing up because he was working in a web environment doing all e-commerce stuff, and he got tired of hammering these people in the core systems. He was feeling awful. He's like, I know they've got all this other stuff to do, but I need them to get me to the services because if I can't get these back from them, I can't get my work done. This guy also explained he invented the tool because his organization was in the process of implementing an enterprise test data solution. Anybody have one of those? Or you really struggle sometimes with test data? He was working in a regulated environment, and the enterprise test data solution wasn't in place. But he needed some real scenarios, and it's illegal to pull data from production, so he used this tool to emulate test data. Down the road, he found he actually had another level of value because when he started working with vendors, they weren't ready. So anyway, they bring an engineer, and he tells us about his pain and his story, and I pass Ken a note. I'm like, I'm in. I'm in. That was it. And Ken and I were on board. How do we do this? Here's the challenge with Ken and Ann doing anything. Ken is pie in the sky, and Ann is Pollyanna. Everything's possible. Everything's optimistic. I tried working earlier in my career. I spent about 3 years in information security. God, I just couldn't do it. You guys ever work with security folks? They're so dark. And I know they're right. I know they're right. I just can't believe that everybody's out to get me. I know they're right. I just am not wired that way. So we got pie in the sky and Pollyanna working together on something. But the good news is that we can usually get people to go along with us. So Ken and I get started. We're like, all right, if we're going to make this work, how do we pick the right project? How do we pick the right project? Well, we said the first thing is it had to be a project we could never get done unless we had this. So we picked the most complicated project. Spaghetti is the only thing I thought would represent it because you get it. We were dependent on vendors. We had data that didn't exist in the test data solution. We had back-end implication systems that didn't want to work with us. We picked the ugliest one that we had told the business, we can't get this done by that date. All right, because this gives us an opportunity to surprise them, to surprise our team, surprise ourselves. You're going to get the biggest bang for your buck trying service virtualization on an ugly spaghetti project. Here's the other thing we knew. The next dimension of picking the right project is we had to have lockstep partnership between the app team and the dev team. A lot of organizations that are introducing service virtualization introduce it to the test team. And they say, test team, we'd like you to roll this out to the enterprise. It's not a testing tool. It's not. I know it's marketed with testing tools. It is not. It is a developer tool developed by developers for developers that can really make testers' lives better. In order to get this working, though, we had to pick a team where the development team and the app team worked well together, or the development team and the test team worked well together, because service virtualization is about quality. It's about shifting, finding your defects early, getting these sophisticated responses, and getting these answers early in the life cycle. As I mentioned earlier, we had Benny and June working on Ken's team. Benny's team was running about 4 months ahead of June's team in the shift to a collaborative work environment. They'd already knocked down all their walls, and they were sitting in an open space. So we had two developers, a tester, an analyst, a business person, and a line leader, all working together, physically together. So Benny's team was set up like that. The other advantage to Benny's team, and another reason why we chose to go there, is one of Benny's developers on that line had been on the test team. He started out as a manual tester and then started to learn automation. He started learning Cucumber and QTP and Ruby and on his own time. And he became the lead of the automation team. And after doing that for about a year, he started learning J2EE and getting certified in Dev, and he earned himself a spot on the app dev team. Perfect. We've got our marriage. We've got that happy relationship between dev and test. They're sitting in an open work environment. They're ready to go agile. They like each other. You cannot underestimate the importance of people liking each other. It matters. Do you ever try to roll out change with people you don't like? You can't, because you spend all your energy thinking, like, I don't like that. I don't like that. We got rid of all that as noise. The third piece in picking the right project is air cover. The project we selected, the spaghetti project, meant that we had a heavy reliance on two of our back-end systems. There was an account system and a billing system. These guys had full schedules already. And in implementing service virtualization, what we are going to do is ask them to stop what they were doing and spend a week with us. Not a month, not 6 weeks, not everything, but we needed a couple developers from each place to spend a week with us. And that can be a lot. When you're already pressed for time and you already have a sprint you're trying to work with and you already have commitments, you got to drop everything. I mean, we gave them the place to charge their time, but it wasn't about charging their time. It was about how many hours do they have in a day. Now, Ken is very popular, super duper easy to get along with. He got it okayed with the app owners over there, found the people. We still needed air cover, because the worst thing that could happen is if Ken's buddy wanders into a staff meeting and mentions to the executive over that area, yeah, and we're doing blah, blah, blah for Ken and Ann with service virtualization, and that his boss wouldn't know about it. You know, boom, the whole thing would come right out at the knees at that point. It's still very tenuous. So what I didn't know is that Ken was a step ahead of me on this. He'd already gotten the executive who runs our area that we rolled up to give him the air cover. Bought in, told him, all right, so we've got it. We have picked our project. We have picked our team. We are ready to go. So now the plot's going to thicken. Now we got to add teeth to it, because we had to explain to the business. Let me roll back the clock a year. A year before we tried service virtualization, we shocked the business with a technique, thanks to Ken for letting me do this to his project and with his team. We had implemented static testing of requirements. Anybody do that? Anyway, so it's formal reviews, walkthroughs, and inspections of requirements. We actually log defects against requirements. And that's actually a topic for another talk, but I can tell you at the start of it, the business team said to me, you know, and you've already ruined, like, you've ruined IT, and we already didn't like it. So I took, but the result of static requirements is testing is not only did we get really good at metrics, but we actually really pulled work out of the pipeline, just going through requirements. If you guys sat through Cheesy's talk, we were scoring stories by value. And what we'd gotten through with static testing is we started chucking things that weren't of value. Or we'd ask questions and realize that the effort that would take is much more than we thought. Is it worth the value? So it was a great exercise. So at this point, Chris and I have picked the Ken and I have picked the project. We're all ready to go. Now we need to bring in our lieutenants. So at this point, we grab the PM. We say, "We're going to make your life better." You think he bought that? No. No, because he's matrixed in from another organization, and he is evaluated on whether or not his projects come in on time, on budget. Now, if he leaves a trail of bodies in his wake, that doesn't matter. If he implements software with a whole bunch of defects, that doesn't matter. If he implements something that we can't support, that doesn't matter. He is measured on date and cost. That's it. So we bring him in, and we realize in order to get his support, those are the two levers we have to hit. If you do service virtualization, how can we collapse your project schedule and lower the cost of your project? All right, that's music to his ears. He's in. He's in. So we say, all right, PM, who do we need to get? Well, of course, we get Benny and we get Daniel. We bring in our architect, and we bring in Benny, Daniel, our architect, and our business partner. And we first thing we did is, if we're going to build virtualized services, let's understand where we have risk, where we have exposure. And we did this exercise where we just drew on the picture. We just, what are all our dependencies? System dependencies, data dependencies, services, competing projects. We just put them all out there. It was this caffeine and sugar-induced brainstorm of ideas and dependencies and risks. And we let our requirements lead really facilitate it. All of a sudden, this is a totally valid project activity because it's not figuring out what services we have. It became a risk identification. It became the start of our risk register for the project. But from there, we prioritized the risks, these dependency risks. We came up with the list of what we needed to virtualize. And guess what? It wasn't as big as we thought. When you put it out there, where are all your risks? We were thinking we needed to virtualize everything. We didn't. We didn't. We needed to virtualize the things that were in the critical path. We needed to virtualize the things that had a lot of competition for resources. So the PM went ahead, and in order to make the case to his leadership and explain why he's going to do this, what he did is took these high-risk dependencies, and when he built out his work breakdown structure, anybody in here, PM, ever build a project plan? All right, well, project management tools let you link each task with a dependency. You can do start to start, finish to finish, start to finish. What he did is actually built these dependencies into the plan and then ran the scheduler. And when we came up with a way more exhaustive list of dependencies and risks than had initially been sized. which is what always happens when you really sit down and you focus on, if we do this, then it also causes that, and we have to pull that. So what we did is came up with a really exhaustive list. So the PM built a great schedule. When we did linear dependencies on just the items we were going to virtualize, he built out the schedule, and it was 8 weeks longer than the business wanted us to go. 8 weeks. There was a committed, somebody had committed and signed up their MBOs for the year that they'd deliver this function on this date. And when we went through the true analysis and understood everything we were waiting for, it was going to take 8 weeks longer. So PM's got the business team's support now. He's got their support. But we needed procurement support too, because this costs money. Buying, we opted to go to the tool. Now with service virtualization, you don't have to get a tool. There are, you can, your development team can actually build their own framework, but there are 4 tools out there that are, they're good. And we'll go through that later. But we opted to use a tool, so that involved money. And as I mentioned earlier, we had done a requirements review, static testing exercise a year earlier. And through that exercise, we'd gotten really good at logging defects. We found some fast, easy ways. I'm sure all of your teams have some type of defect repository. There's all sorts of data you can get on there. We were in the process of moving from waterfall to agile. So these are waterfall metrics, but they're just as easy to grab from agile. Because even if you're running multiple iterations, at some point you're still going to bundle a lot of things together to come up with a full release, or you're going to integrate with other applications around you. What we decided to do is take all of the defects we found in IT, ST, PT, UAT, the later in the lifecycle defects, when multiple lines started coming together, and we are targeting a 30% reduction in those defects. That was our hypothesis. If we can test these modules with high degrees of interdependency before we ever get to an integrated environment, we're going to find 30% fewer defects when we're in the interdependency testing environment. Does that make sense? I mean, if you can get valid tests, you send a request, you get a reasonable response, and you process that response, you can actually test your module before you get to an integrated environment with a real response. The other dimension of this is when we get into an integrated environment, we're going to be able to do our first pass. We all know the challenge when you're running a full like SIT cycle is to get through execution of all of your scripts. That first pass through is the hardest, but it's the most important because you expose all your potential defects. Service virtualization lets you accelerate your trip through first pass. Because is there anybody in the room who's ever gotten to an integrated environment and you had all your dependencies there? No. So folks on the webcast, not a single person in the room raised his or her hand, because none of us has ever been there. Things happen through a delivery cycle that makes it very difficult to achieve. So what we did in building our business case, again, we took, in this example, 456 defects. So 30% of that's 130-something, 135 or more. Let's say, because I had a team that was data, very, very data-driven, we knew it was actually about 8 hours per defect found in a testing cycle to cause them to fix. So we said, hey, five hours. Let's knock some off there and be ultra-conservative. We're only signing up for a 30% reduction in the defects in these later cycles and 5 hours of defects. It's not huge. When we ran this, I'll come back to this. We actually, if we had that 30% reduction, We signed up for $60,000. 30% reduction, 135 defects, 5 hours apiece, $60,000. So we said we would get a $60,000 payback and a collapse, a four-week collapse in our schedule. Everyone signed up for it. Because I promise you that you would walk away with three things. I don't like slides with words on them, but here are the words. This is exactly the formula you need to go through to get the math to figure out what you're going to save. Get the data from a previous project, your defect data from a previous project. Pull the numbers from sit and later. So once you get, what I did with this team is we do a smoke test, and then you'd move into integration test. At integration, that's when I'd start the counter. So I'd take it from a previous project, similar size, similar complexity, and say, integration defects, we're going to reduce them by 30%, and we're going to say 5 to 10 hours of defect based on whatever your numbers are. Go conservative and sign up. Say we have a potential savings of $60,000. It's hard dollars. It's real math. It's based on facts and data. So here are the results. And yeah, those are my kids. And they weren't happy about our positive results. They were happy because I took them to Dairy Queen. And I am not the sweet tooth mom, so they thought that was pretty cool, so they made faces. Usually dad does that. You guys, everybody else have that, like the good parent, good cop, bad cop? Yeah. My husband's the one that indulges them in funnel cakes and stuff like that. So the great news is we do this. It actually worked. We signed up for 4 weeks. We reduced the schedule by 6 weeks. We signed up for a 30% reduction. You guys, we had a 60% reduction. We can even build virtualized services for everything. We isolated our virtualized services to three things. One of those back-end systems, one vendor, and some key data that was restricted that hadn't been populated in our enterprise test data system. It was not huge. We spent about 10 days building services. That's it. It was not a break the bank. This was a handful of people kicking out some services, putting them in there, and then everybody using them. So we're thinking everything's all great. But with every good story, dun, 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 there's a conflict. We thought we've created this new toy for all the developers and the testers to use. We've created a source of happiness. But you'll notice this swing set is unused. Because that's what we had done. We'd invested in this deluxe rainbow play system, and hardly anybody was using it. Instead of having the whole neighborhood on this gigantic swing set where there was room for everybody, we had one team, a couple kids using it. We totally weren't getting our value, which is how I found this wacky pack of a dud. Does anybody remember wacky packs? Weren't they fun? Totally dating myself. It's okay. Because they still make me laugh. So Ken and I are on our way over to Subway, which is where we always went to lunch. As de facto lunch partners, we had to have a de facto lunch destination, just Subway. Because Ken eats meat, I'm a vegetarian. But we both like a jumbo iced tea. You really cannot go wrong with a jumbo iced tea at lunch. It's that extra little something to get you through the afternoon. So Ken and I wander over there, and we're like, how did we do this? How did we just invest way too much money in a giant rainbow play system? It totally worked, and yet we got it wrong. So we're crossing the bridge over to Subway. Who do we run into? Edward and Gus. Yeah. The hero of the story hasn't even been mentioned, and we went all the way through the plot. So we run into Edward. He's like, Hey, man, how's that service virtualization thing working out for you? We've been waiting to hear back from you. And it was like, oh, you gotta be kidding me. We totally missed the obvious. We totally missed the obvious. We hadn't used the team that was put in place to make developers' lives better. We hadn't used them. Oh, I skipped a little part of my story. Let me go back. Back to the swing set and the duds. So Benny's team had been using it. We invited June's team to get started. So June's team gets started using it, ignores everything Benny's team had ever done, rebuilt their own services, named them a separate way, invoked them a separate way. Daniel's pulling his hair out. He's going back to his long suffering, coming over to my desk. I'm so frustrated. We just went through this whole exercise with Benny, and it worked great. But June insists on doing it a totally separate way. So, here we were completely befuddled, and we had missed the essence of developing and bringing in a tool that's a culture change. Sir, your implementation of service virtualization is going to be a dud if you don't address the fact that this is a cultural change that needs to drive the way developers set up, construct their code, and validate their code. It needs to influence the way teams interact. Hey, guys, I know I recognize you've got this going on, but we've got this project going on. Can we stand up? Can we take a day, throw a couple services in place, and we can keep moving at the same time and come together when you're ready and we're ready. But in the meantime, when we come together, we get something better. So here's my proposal. And this is from implementing service virtualization a couple times in a couple organizations and having doing really well in one, doing really well in another. And I've created this. This is kind of my merged model of how you implement service virtualization. The heart is in your organization, whether you're a big organization or a small organization. You have a group somewhere that rolls up under the CTO that defines your application engineering standards. If you're a super sophisticated organization like Google, these are your Bible. I mean, this is the language you use. This is the tech stack you use. If you're an organization that's maybe big and you've got some of these legacy applications that do major transaction processing, you probably have a few tech stacks. But there's a group in your CTO's organization that comes up with the rules. These are the coding standards. These are the tools. If your app engineering organization is really good, they're also driving a community of practice. You're getting developers out of their silos, even if their silos align, and it's getting them to share ideas. We need to take a lot of the lessons we have from Agile that we're going to learn on the fly, that requirements are going to change, that we don't have fixed scope. We learn. We got to bring that back to developers. It's not just for the applications we're building. It's not just for our business teams. It's for those of us who are in technology professions. Languages change and evolve. How many versions of JBoss are out there? They change and evolve. And as communities of practice, developers, we got to pull ourselves out of our silos and off of our lines and come together with other people who are in other silos and other lines and hear their stories and learn from them. And your shared service, your app engineering team drives that. Really good implementation of service virtualization puts a community of practice right in there in that group. Hey, developers from across the enterprise, developers on different platforms using different technologies, service virtualization is available to help you get through your service needs, your vendor dependencies, your cross-team dependencies, your data dependencies. Let them understand it. Ken and I got all ambitious and tried to go off and do it on our own, which is great because we proved it. We proved that it worked. We also proved that you can't roll it out in a silo. You have to think about the bigger picture. So the next key piece in this model is the app team. Notice I am not talking about the quality team. You cannot bring service virtualization in through your quality team. It's got to come in through your app team. One of the reasons why service virtualization worked is that Ken introduced it. Ken, pie in the sky, innovative app dev guy, is an app dev guy. And Ken's peers, Barbie, Skipper, and others across the enterprise, respected other people in app dev. You know, I hadn't been in quality very long before I realized that we were the redheaded stepchildren. I didn't command the same type of technical respect Ken did, not because I didn't have just a strong technical background, but because I had moved to a profession that didn't command that respect. You know, right, wrong, or indifferent, doesn't matter. Ken had the organizational clout, and I'm sure, and no matter where I've been, whether it's as an employee or consulting, I see the same pattern. App managers, app dev people, respect app dev people. Play a huge role in this. So an app dev manager makes sure his team's using it. Hey, developers, this is a tool for you. You can create your own sandbox to fiddle around if you set up your own services. Oh, development team, we can really enhance the development environment that you guys share when we use services. Hey, development team, you can pass some of these services along to your test team if we're getting to a point in integration where dependencies aren't available and they need to do the first pass through testing. Huge. App teams, to me, are the ones, they decide whether or not they're going to adopt it. The third key cog in this wheel is the quality team or the test team. Depends, you know, some organizations, they're just testing. Some, they're QA and testing. Some, they're actually quality engineering and on all the processes. They're the third piece. Where I've seen service virtualization, and now I'm on a couple customer advisory boards, so I see it working in different organizations, different ways. When your quality team enforces the use of it and expects the use of it, that's when you have real teeth. Put it in the quality plan. Not just your test plan, and a good test plan, if you've ever seen it, is really a quality plan. It's, these are the processes we're going to solve. This is the method we're going to use. There's also an environment component of that. And the quality team should drive that exercise I talked about earlier, the dependency exercise. Expose your dependencies, prioritize the dependencies, and put this in the quality plan that for those dependencies, we're actually going to put services, virtualized services in here. So expect your development teams to use it. Help them prioritize which services. If you get really sophisticated, go through the inventory of existing services and call out, we're going to just use these. They're already there. This second thing that test teams should do is enforce this with gates and entrance criteria. Now, if we're doing Agile, the only time you're going to have an entrance criteria is when you get into the point, if you're in a big or a regulated new organization, you have to start bundling rollout from different lines. That's really the only valid line, valid point where you'd have entrance or exit criteria. But make one of those criteria. Hey, bring me your virtualized services in case we need them. And show me your test results that you've executed complete execution and let me know where you use virtualized services versus where you used real data or real services, real dependencies. Then you can see in there in fine print coming along the side, I don't want to underscore the importance of vendor partners. There are four organizations that I've seen put in service virtualization very well. And Vidal Sassoon said it best, if you don't look good, we don't look good. Reach out to your vendor partners. it's very important to them that if you choose to use service virtualization, you do it right. Because if you are successful, it shows that their product and their method works. You've got people who've gone from organization to organization and put this in. Let them help you. If you bake it into your cost, you figure out the vendors don't want you to fall on your face. So use it. One of the mistakes I don't want anybody to make when putting this in is using a command and control model. This is not, I see one organization that had huge results coming right out of the gate with service virtualization. One team set up all the virtualized services. One group of people, there were six guys, and they could knock out services faster than anybody. So they got more value faster than anybody else. But what happens when one of those guys decides he wants to do something else? All right, their productivity drops off. And also, nobody really has a sense of ownership. That team does service virtualization. Federated model is your method for success. I'm going to go a little bit deeper in here. Oh, now I've got my happy story. Yeah, it's next. So let me take federated model a little bit deeper. One of the things I really like is if we go back to the shared services team, it's a great idea to have some folks on that team who could come in and augment an app team. So let's say an app team really says, you guys, we can't do it. We don't have expertise. We don't have the time. That's okay. Between our vendor partner and our shared services team, we're going to have a guy or two sit on your line and actually stand up your services for you and build your initial category or help you come up with your initial inventory so that you've got some critical mass to work with. So fast forward about 2.5 years later. I've moved on to another team. Ken's moved on. Edward's still there. He's still running his shared service, and I ran into Gus at a customer advisory board. I said, Gus, tell me what happened. And it was a really great story, but Gus is an interesting character, one we'd underutilized in this whole process. Gus was wildly popular in the organization, had worked there forever, knew everyone. Gus's job was to drive adoption of service virtualization. He used his personal network. He introduced this person to that person and said, oh, hey, have you talked to so-and-so? He had a lot of success with this. And he really fostered a grassroots adoption of service virtualization. So service virtualization is never, never something you top-down mandate, you must virtualize services. No. It's one guy who feels a certain amount of pain, who knows another gal who feels the same pain, and introducing them, and they talk through it. And Gus really worked on this informal network. The next thing Gus did that was crazy smart, he became the keeper of metrics. So Ken and I had some great success, and we kept track of it. When we got Barbie to use it, she had some great success, and we kept track of it. Gus started pulling all these numbers. So he goes out to groups beyond Ken, Barbie, and Skipper, and he starts pulling all these numbers together. And he starts to build enterprise metrics of the value we're getting. This is huge. This is a huge, it's a great way for teams to celebrate success. So it's like fertilizing your grassroots efforts. You know, when people hear, when we did this, we had this much more success. You know, the grass is getting greener and thicker. But it took time. I mean, this is 2.5 years later. I ran into Gus, and service virtualization wasn't the exception. It was the norm. But it had been driven by developers, for developers, fully embraced and celebrated by quality teams and promoted by the app engineering team. It doesn't matter the size of your organization. That's a natural human dynamic, whether these are separate teams, merged teams, sitting in one building or across the globe from each other. The same ideas come into play. So to make them more concrete, because I promised you'd know how to set up your team for success, I actually wrote it down. I don't like words and slides, but here you go. Here are some words. I don't know what your shared service team is called, if it's app engineering or whatever, but let's call it your center of excellence. What should your center of excellence do? Well, you know, Gus really stole the show when he started to collect and bring everybody's metrics together, because he's celebrating community of application engineers and app developers. When you work together and you embrace the tool, this is the result you can have. He also did some real detailed things like enforcing naming standards. And if you get your autographed copy of How Google Tests Software, you can see how naming standards are a very critical part in basic application engineering. You have better naming standards, it's so easy to find things. He also, Gus really made an easy-to-use catalog that everyone could access. You know, when Ken and I built it, we built one for this team, and Benny went off and used it, and then June used a different catalog. Gus put an end to that, brought it all together. He brought it all together. And then Gus really started adding some muscle to the team. So everyone who said, no, we can't do it, we don't have time, Gus added staff. He's like, hey, I'm going to loan you a person. Gus was clever enough in his funding that he paid for that person. So teams didn't have an excuse to say no. Like, I don't want to pay for that person. Gus sent him over there. And the last thing Gus did that I thought was really extraordinary was he would pull people, he'd invite them into his community of practice meetings, having regular brown bags, setting up, we had an internal, social networking. So there was a community there, and he facilitated it, invited people in and started conversations. Huge. Really drove adoption. Next key player, application owner. Yes, these are the champions, my friends. I just wanted to say that. But these guys are the ones who say we are going to use it or we're not going to use it. So app owners, expect it from your developers and then recognize the people who are doing it and having such a huge impact. Talk it up. If you're an app owner and you've tried it and you've had great success, again, I mentioned Ken had tons of organizational credibility. Talk it up. Way more than, doesn't matter if I could code in more languages than Ken. Ken had the app owner title. So when he talked it up, people listened. Make it a standard and expect it from people. Your test team, put in your quality plan. When you do run that risk analysis, identify all your dependencies, because those are the ones that are going to kill you when in your schedule. Work with your PM on this. But again, notice PM's not the key person here. Test teams, you got to do this. Put it in the plan, the environment plan, entrance criteria, and then use it. Instead of getting that pain point like, oh, we can't get through our first pass execution because blah, blah, blah isn't ready, throw up a virtualized service and get past it, because you've got to get through the first run of all your test scripts to expose all your critical defects. And my last piece is vendor partners. Guys, they're good at it. If you're struggling with how to set up your metrics, how to document how schedules collapsed, they have formulas they put in place. They'll work with you and work on your data, because, again, it's important to their success that you're successful. So don't let those be adversarial relationships. Make them partnerships. When they understand your environment better and they're able to help you, you could really influence the development and the direction of the tools. So I wanted to leave 15 minutes for questions. Three things. I'm going to make sure you guys got them. You know how to pick the right project now. Spaghetti, app dev, test partnership, and air cover. Those are the three key pieces to picking the right project. Building the business case, it's got to be concrete and mathematical. There's two ways to build the business case. Number one, schedule compression. How many weeks are you able to take off your schedule because you can do concurrent development and testing? And the second is defect reduction. You've got the method of looking for 30% improvement at 5 hours. And the last And the most important piece is setting your team up to be successful. Use your shared services organization, drive the community of practice, engage your app teams, and then test teams just expect it. This is about simplifying your environment. And follow me on Twitter so I can show my 19-year-old nephew that you can, old dog, teach a new trick. I mentioned there are four vendors. I wanted to make sure you know the four that I've worked with and I've seen be very successful. It depends on which one you use, do the most work with, or you have the best relationship with, but they're all good partners. They're equally valid. So I invite you to reach out to your vendor partners and give it a shot. They'll help you be good at it. And with that, thank you, and I'm going to open up and see where we have questions. Yes. Can you build in a service that takes into account network latency? That's a really good question. Yes, you can put in a service that simulates. Yes, you can absolutely do that. I might argue, though, so let's say, and this is usually one of the first and best applications of service virtualization is in performance testing. You want to prove that it's not your module causing the pain. So the first thing you want to test is just ignoring network latency. You want to see how if your module can take the volume on its own, and then you can add a simulation of network latency and see how it responds. But yes, you absolutely can do that. Anything else in the room?
You said that there were a couple of pre-existing tools out there. Do you have any examples of those?
So examples of tools that are out there. The CA Lisa tool was the first service virtualization tool out there. The guy who developed it is now the CTO of CA, he's a roll-up-your-sleeves developer who made up this tool to make it work. Now, it's not rocket science. There are a couple firms I've talked to, like consulting firms, who absolutely refuse to use a tool. See, you don't have to have a tool to do service virtualization. Absolutely do not have. But some of these tools make it really easy to get started fast. So your classic is it's going to depend on the skills in your organization, the expertise, the appetite, if you already have a deep relationship with a vendor. What I like about some of these tools is they're going to help you get over to DevOps a little bit faster. They do a nice integration into the continuous build. So if you're truly working in an agile environment, service virtualization is really necessary because it's the only thing that lets you have multiple lines going on at the same time that maybe there could be a complete overlap in what they need to do. And service virtualization lets you guys, you can thoroughly test your piece, let you get to test-driven development without waiting for other lines.
We've got some questions from the virtual audience now. Do you always emulate existing behavior, or could you build new behavior?
Oh, that's a great question. So the question is, do you always emulate existing behavior, or can you create new behavior? Absolutely create new behavior. Let's go with existing behavior. One of the things you can do, one of the reasons I like tools, is you can actually set them up to be like a DVR. So let's say I'm integrating with an account system, and we work together all the time, but the account system's about to go off and do some type of upgrade, and they need to come out of the environment. I can just record, our interaction. I record them, and then I can save the recording off as the virtualized service. So that's one of the reasons why you want to do a tool. They do a nice record. But let's say they're going offline because they want to build a new feature function. What I can do with service virtualization is tack on to those. When we design that new feature function over here, what is the response going to be? And you actually add that just to your inventory of services. So that's a phenomenal use of service virtualization. Another new feature function, one of the things we were doing at this place where I was, we were rolling out a service to a new state, and there were regulations about not using critical information from that state. We were actually able to set up virtualized services that mimicked that state. So it was nothing that existed before, nothing we were even allowed to do. So we used virtualized services so we could test our code to handle all the conditions of that state. This is a very good question. We have anything else from the web?
Yes, we've got a couple more. How much effort does it take to develop a general enough virtual service compared to developing the real service? Mm. How about this network latency simulator doing the required simulation?
All right, let me take the first piece. How much time does it take to set up a virtual service versus a regular service? My team this past fall was dealing with a very common vendor, widely used in financial services institutions. And that vendor needed 12 weeks to get our services stood up. But we needed that same 12 weeks to do development. So to stand up our virtualized services took 3.5 days. That was it. 3.5 days. And then we were able to completely overlap our schedules. So virtualized services go up extremely quickly because it's just a veneer. It's not any of the logic or the thought on the back end. It's just, well, when we're done coding this, our response will be X. What was part two of the question? It was about latency.
Yes. How about this network latency simulator doing the required simulation?
How about this network latency simulator doing the required simulation? Same thing. What you'll do is actually in your response you put in the delay, and it's really a configuration of the tool. It's absolutely possible. You kind of have to get in there into the tool in the environment, but you can trigger the response. Don't respond until you've gone past X number of seconds or X fraction of a second. We've got a question in the front row.
I was wondering if you've ever had need to use it as a tool for fault injection across other pieces of your application for testing purposes?
Have I ever used it as a tool for fault injection? Actually, yes. We used it as a tool for fault injection when we had some scenarios. We're trying to hit like some boundary conditions or some scenarios we couldn't find any data that existed. So just unlikely things to find. So yes, we did virtualized services to inject that in there. Absolutely, it's a great use of it. And when we got really good at setting up virtualized services, we could get those set up in 15, 20 minutes. It gave us much higher confidence. And in dealing with a regulated industry, we could link those right into a test case. So when we come in and we're getting audited and they say, well, what about this? We were able to show how we used a virtualized service that was at fault condition and how the system reacted to it. Very powerful.
Is service virtualization compatible with continuous integration?
Oh, great question. Is service virtualization compatible with continuous integration? Absolutely. It is. A lot of the tools that you are moving to continuous integration are assuming that you've used service virtualization. So it can help you get to continuous integration faster. It's going to depend on the tool and your organization's architecture and how you handle your movement between environments, but absolutely, service virtualization can accelerate your movement to continuous integration.
All right, another one from virtual audience. Do you see any relation between service virtualization and specification by example?
Do you see any similarities between service virtualization and specification by example? I don't totally understand the question, so I don't want to misanswer. Maybe we can get some clarification. Can you ask for some clarification on that question?
Thank you.
But I can say you can actually set up services. One of the things we did later on when we got really good at service virtualization and we do risk, the development of services is actually one of the first things we did. The same thing like you write your test case, we wrote, the first thing we developed were our virtualized services. So when we knew we flat out weren't going to get to something, so we would do those up front. Anything else? Well, I know we're running awfully close to time, and I think it was pretty good given this was nap time. And everybody had their blue cots out in the form of red and gold cushy chairs. So I want to thank you all for coming, for participating, for the good questions. Again, if you think of something later on, you've got my email address. Just put service virtualization in the title and enjoy the rest of the conference. This is a great lineup. There's some excellent vendors out there too.